Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Happy Mother's Day to all the ladies of the world. Whether you are mothers by birth or mothers who have spiritually given birth to others, we want to thank all of you ladies for being in our lives and for God for giving us daughters and sisters and mothers. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of womanhood. We thank you for our sisters in our lives. We thank you for their tender touch, their compassion, their understanding, their love of peace, their love of home, their love of security. Things in this world that are vanishing so fast. I ask you to strengthen my sisters, your daughters, Father, this day, to make them strong for the year ahead, but also to let them revel in the love of their families, that they may feel more love today than they have felt in a long, long time, and that they might reflect that perfect love that you have for us back through their eyes and their words to us. So come, Brother Jesus, come, Lord King, and bless your sisters. Make them to shine like the face of God in this world, and bring us the peace that only heaven can bring. And all of God's people said, amen.
Good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you. You're very, very welcome here today, every day, but especially today on this Mother's Day, the day that we get to honor our mothers. What a great and wonderful thing that is to be able to honor our mothers for the way that they've loved us. And I might say that it's for a good mother, it's an example of a godly love. And for those of you, I know that some of you online here perhaps might not have had mothers that set the type of example that they should have. And thank God, though, that we have a church that loves us, and we have a place where we can ask those people and welcome those people and tell them they can come here and feel the love that God has, which is the perfect example of what the love of mother should be. Can we stand up and sing this song? It's a song we're going to honor God with. This, it's called How Great Thou Art. And for all you that are used to the traditional version of this, we're going to put a little bit of a country twang onto that. I hope that's all right. My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the tree,
when I look down from lofty mountains grander and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. And when I think that God is Son, not sparing, send him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died. Take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then shall I bow in humble adoration and proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. How great thou art.
You know, I know that this next song is not about moms, but I got to admit, I get, when I think about this, it reminds me of the comfort that I would get when I was with my mom and just being around her. And that's why I say that you can feel, you know, when you think of parenting and when somebody does it right, there's a real godliness about it. And it's just such a beautiful view of God. Hi, Bob. Hi, fellas. It's just such a beautiful view of God. So let's sing this song. It's just a gentle, gentle song. I
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own,
his own.
And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me his own, and the joy we shared as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'll stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go. Through the voice of woe, his voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own,
his own.
And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
And the joy.
And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing, power and majesty, praise. Seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Shout to the Lord.
Shout to the Lord, all the earth let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hand. Forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Does anything compare? Think about it. Does anything in this world compare of Scott, my monitor's freaking out over there. Never mind. Thought I was at the ocean the whole time I was singing. It was kind of nice. But anyway, does anything compare? Does anything in this world compare to Jesus Christ? We're going to have, please, if you can bring, if you have an offering today, it's time to bring that up to the front. And if you're online, you can go to www.clintonnazarene.org, and there are ways to give online. Invite my daughter to come up and sing this next song with us. I somehow always gravitate towards songs that just tell about how mighty and powerful and how awesome God is. And I think you'll agree with me that this song really, really tells you and shows, makes you feel the power of God. When I sing this song, I feel like I'm in heaven already. I feel like I'm up there with all my brothers and sisters, and God is just out in front of us, and we're just singing behind him. So can you stand and let's sing it. I want to be close, close to your side, so heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one, hallelujah, holy, holy. God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee. God Almighty, the great I am. I want to be near, near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I want to see dry bones living again, singing as one, hallelujah, holy, holy, God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. The mountains shake before you, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell, nor any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am. Great I am, the great I am, the great. In shape before you, the demons run and flee. At the mention of your name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell, nor any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am, the great I am, the great I am. The great I am.
Good morning again, everybody. Please be seated. Well, we got a lot of announcements going on, and I want to announce that we now have 45 kids signed up for VBS. And climbing, it seems about every 2 or 3 days, I just see some more, one or two, and they're chiming in, and we are still, a long way out. We're more than 2 months still out. So we're definitely going to get to our number where we're going to have to probably cut off who can even come in. And that's always a sad time if that happens. But we're thankful that God is moving and that people are waking up slowly but surely and coming back into his house and to his people. So we're going to need lots of workers. So if you're not signed up for something, first thing I saw was Bob and Phyllis's beautiful shiny face coming through that door. And I thought, aha, I have somebody I know will serve food, somebody who will help Christy at that morning table and get all those kids in and out. And just wonderful to see both of you back with us. And praise be to God for what he's done in Bob's life. Now, free of cancer again. And you got beautiful tans, both of you. You've been down there in that sun. You know, the music today, before I even go on to another announcement, my father's favorite, because he was a Catholic, so my father's favorite Protestant hymn was How Great Thou Art. And he wanted us to bury him to that song. And this morning we were singing that, I could see him up in heaven cheering us on. The next song is my mother's mother, my maternal grandmother's favorite song, A Walk With You Alone in the Garden. And she used to play that for us when we were 3 and 4, you know, with records, remember, and that big phonograph thing that you lifted up, and it had the 8-track player, and now I use them for doorstops, right? But I remember growing up to hearing that song and my grandmother singing as she would make dinner for us and care for us, like grandmas do. And then we got to the third song, and that's my favorite, Shout to the Lord. And I hardly ever hear it anymore. It's kind of one of those older, you know, Darlene Desch song, Darlene Zesch and the group. And I was singing all I could back there. And that fourth song is one of my wife's all-time favorites, which she requested that the group do today. And they did. And in a second, I get to hear two more ladies. We just heard a beautiful voice of Natalie. A mother to be sometime down the road when that right man comes, and I keep praying for that. We get to hear my wife, and I hardly ever get to hear her. She'll hum around the house, you know, I'll hear her voice. But I get to hear her sing, How Beautiful Is the Body of Christ Coming Up. And then I get to hear my counterpart in ministry preach about women, Pastor Lori. What a beautiful day it is. Sometimes we just need to stop and reflect. Evangelism as a lifestyle will continue next Sunday. And Sophia, thank you. Nancy, thank you. Those two ladies are leading us into a whole nother place. And now comes the fun part, role playing and learning how to do that. And I'm kind of thinking about not even being at that session, so no one even bothers with what I have to say. I might just skip it. If I do, it's not because I don't love you. I want other people to have a chance because it's a chance of a lifetime to tell people about the saving love of Jesus Christ. So I hope you can be a part of that. We're having a great time. Women's conference coming up. Not a lot of time to talk about it because it's right on top of us. June 4th and 5th. And Pastor Lori and three other ladies will be speaking at that women's conference, okay? Celebrating the daughters of God and empowering them for ministry. Communion will be coming next. So with that said, I'd like to lead us into that by bowing our heads and invoking God's special presence among us. Holy Spirit, we ask you now that you move in this place. We ask you that you bring us the love of the Father through the broken body and precious blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Father, when you were here, your Son did two things. He seeked and he saved the lost. That was one of his two missions in life. The other one was to serve. And in a few seconds, we'll hear these beautiful words reflected in song written down by Twyla Paris, one of your daughters. How beautiful the hands that served, the wine and the bread and the sons of the earth. How beautiful the feet that walked the long dusty road to the cross. How beautiful, how beautiful, how beautiful is the body of Christ, broken for you, given for you. And as I look at you, the people of the body of Christ, and I think of how much he loves you, my heart is strangely warmed. So I'm going to ask you now to come forward and receive the body and blood of Christ. Come up and get it. Take it back to your seats. Melinda will play in the background now, and then we'll take it together after this beautiful song.
How beautiful.
Before we partake of this, I want to thank my wife for making me a father. Waited over almost 16 years. We waited and we waited. I want to thank my two daughters, Victoria and Crystal, for giving us 7 beautiful grandchildren. I want to thank my great-grandparents, Mary and Amelia. I want to thank my grandmothers, Virginia and Gertruda, who gave me faith. I want to thank my mother and my mother-in-law, who is a very special lady. Not many men can say they love their mother-in-law like they love their own mother. To Marilyn, amen. Michael, amen. You got a good one there. To Marilyn and to Joy. To Joyce, my mother. Thank you, Father, for the beautiful gift to show us half of all that you are in the ladies of this world. May we long for peace, even in battle. May we long for love and compassion, even in strife. Thank you, Father. We now partake of the bread and the blood of your only Son. May it set us free to heaven. I'd like to read to you this morning from the book of Exodus. And then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew midwives, of whom the name was one was Shiphrah and the other Puah. And he said, when you do the duties of a midwife for the Hebrew women, and you see them among their birth stools, if it is a son, then you shall kill him. But if it is a daughter, you shall keep her alive. But the midwives feared God, and they did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the male children alive. And so the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, why have you done this thing and saved the male children alive? And the midwives replied to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are lively and they give birth before the midwives come to them. Therefore, God dwelt well with those midwives, and the people multiplied, and they grew mighty. And so it was because the midwives feared God that he even provided households for them. And so Pharaoh commanded all of his people, saying, every son who is born you shall cast into the river, and every daughter you shall keep alive. And a man of the house of Levi went and took as a wife a daughter of Levi. And so the woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a beautiful child, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could no longer hide him, she took and made an ark of bulrushes for him. And she daubed it in and out with asphalt and with pitch. And she put the child into the basket and laid it in the reeds along the river's bank. And his sister stood afar off to know what would become of him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river along with her maidens. And they walked along the riverside, and when she saw that the ark was among the reeds, she sent out one of her maids to get it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby wept. And so she had great compassion on him. And she said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. And then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call a nurse for you from among the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you? And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. And so the maiden went and called the child's mother. And then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages. And the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And so she called his name Moses, saying, because I drew him out of the water, the word of the Lord. We've gotten out of practice, and we talked about this the other day, of praying for each other when we are about to bring the word of God. It's because we're so scared of something we shouldn't be scared of. We should want the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen, everyone?
Amen.
Bow your heads with me and let us pray for Pastor Lori. Lord, we ask now a special anointing by your Holy Spirit to speak through your daughter to us, that we might come to know you better, Father, that we might fall in love with you more, Lord Jesus, and that we might be more obedient and more loving to all by the power of the Spirit who lives within all of us. Come now, Holy One, and speak to your servant. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen.
It's already been a powerful morning, amen. The Lord is with us. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. And so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. And God said, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And so fatherhood and motherhood came into being. A special man and a special woman designed to perfectly complement one another and take dominion over the earth. And Adam called his wife's name Eve because she was the mother of all living. Today is Mother's Day, and here we're here to celebrate the attributes of God that were given to woman in extra doses so that they or we could be empowered to be motherly today. It is our intent to get a glimpse into the beauty of God's image that we see as the daughters of God become women of faith and vision. You see, in that time so long ago, that first couple were the first human son and daughter of God. Each one of you here today is a son or a daughter of that very same Heavenly Father, with Christ our brother there from the very beginning. We do know that Adam and Eve messed things up a long time ago, so not all of us have mothers or fathers, for that matter, that display the attributes of God as God intended. Yet if we look at the women we know, or the women we are, those attributes that are good and holy will resonate. Human failure is overcome by God's perfect love. So yes, God in three persons, one in Father, Son, and Spirit. It is by his Spirit that the fullness of God's love can be reflected into the world by his sons and daughters. God is father, mother, brother, sister to us all. How cool is that? For today, as you listen, I would like for you to gain a deeper and better understanding of just how much God loves you and loves you perfectly. Celebrate Mother's Day, and we will do the same in June for Father's Day by celebrating your precious mother, whether she is with us here on earth or not. For me this morning, it's my first Mother's Day without my mother. While also celebrating, you're hearing that we're celebrating my tears right now, God's feminine characteristics and deep compassionate love through the eyes of women. Our mothers are precious to our Lord, no matter how perfect or imperfect they are. For those of us that are mothers, we can grasp some of these concepts from our own experience. Sometimes we get it right. Often we don't, yet the Lord is still there. For those of you who are not mothers, know that you too have these attributes as women and can display them in the care and love for others, whether they are children or adults. All of us can use a little mothering now and again. Amen. Keep in mind that these are qualities that women have because they were created in the image of God. God is love. So his image in us is that perfect love. Please also understand that one can be a biological mother without God. But oh, how much better it is when a woman is open to be a channel of the highest blessing that come from God, the indwelling presence of the Spirit, available to display the fullness of the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. No pressure here, ladies. Let's now go to our story from Scripture to examine those daughterly and motherly characteristics. There are quite a few women in this story, each with a role to play. Three of them had a great love for this baby boy, a love that held precious his life, a love that caused them to desire the baby be delivered from death, a love that was nurturing, protective, and sacrificial. A love that was unconditional. Beyond that love, and maybe the most powerful and prominent, was that God would go before them and make a way when the way seemed impossible. We can see God and God's image through their actions. Let's start with the backdrop and how God utilized the women of their day to pave the way for the deliverer of God's people, Moses. And then the king of Egypt spoke to the Hebrew wives, of whom the name of one was Shiphrah and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when you do the duties of midwife for the Hebrew women and see them on the birthstool, if it is a son, then you shall kill him. Can you imagine? Women whose occupation was to assist in the delivery of brand new and precious life were being ordered to kill the baby boys as soon as they were born. One of the midwives' name was Shiphrah, a name that means justice, and Puah, a name that means little child. In combining those names, we have justice for the little ones, the ones who had no voice. In a time when Pharaoh was ordering infanticide, Shiphrah and Puah were positioned to bring justice for the ones who also had no voice. Pharaoh had decided that the Israelites, despite their enslavement, were growing too strong, so the number of boys would be reduced or eliminated for a period of time. Horrible. And the midwives were being required to carry out the order. Was it fair or just or right to kill a little child right after its birth? There's a song written by Phil Keggy that says it this way. Who will speak up for the little ones, helpless and half abandoned? They've got the right to choose life. They don't want to lose. I've got to speak up, won't you? Let's see how Shiphrah and Puah spoke up to bring justice for the little ones of their day. But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but he saved the male children alive. The role of the women who were midwives was important. They were Egyptian women assisting in the birth of the Israelite children. We see the use of the words feared God, which means that these women, although Egyptian, had faith and understood that these mothers believed in a single God with great power and authority. Whom will you serve, God or Pharaoh? Whom will you fear, God or Pharaoh? Who is sovereign, God or Pharaoh? Still today, we are all called upon to respect legitimate government authority, but never, never is the believer called upon to obey a command that directly violates the law of the kingdom of God. And when put into that predicament, the believer has no choice but to fear God rather than man by choosing life. That is precisely what these brave, godly, courageous, faithful women did. And God uses their faithfulness to confound the plans of the evil one. These women feared God more than a mere mortal man, and Pharaoh was enraged. So the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this thing and saved the male children?" "Because the Hebrew women are not like Egyptian women, for they are lively and give birth before midwives can come to them. Knowing what we know about the Egyptians and their belief in many gods, do you wonder how they knew to say this in this situation? They were dissing their own women by saying that the Israelite women were so strong that they didn't need, the midwives. So Pharaoh commanded all his people, saying, "Every son who is born, you shall cast into the river, and every daughter you shall save alive." So Pharaoh commanded all his people, and evil continued to reign. By faith, we're going to move a little bit in our story here, because God wasn't letting it go, right? We see twice that he's ordered this horrible thing, but God wasn't letting it go. And I've moved to utilize a scripture in Hebrews that says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's command. And this man, his name was Amram of the house of Levi, and he went and took as a wife a daughter of Levi. So the woman, Jochebed, conceived and bore a son. And Amram from the house of Levi is a priest, and his name means exalted one. Think about that. We've already seen the names of the midwives. Now we've got here the exalted one who stands in the place of people. Yoshi, as we can call her, is a daughter of Levi, her name with the meaning delights in the glory of God. Jochebed delights in the glory of God. Think of the prophecy that was to be fulfilled by the marriage of these two people and the birth of their son. God, as they refer to the Lord Yahweh, is glorified and exalted through his people. In the most human and godly of ways, Yoshi was to deliver into the world the one who would be used by God to deliver God's people from slavery. Married to a priest whose very role was to cry out to Yahweh on behalf of the people, beseeching the Lord's mercy, asking for their deliverance from bondage. Isaiah 66, "Shall I bring the time of birth and not cause delivery, says the Lord?" Amram and Jochebed, both destined to be deliverers. Mother and father coming together in faith, the inborn instinct of a mother to nurture and protect and provide security for her newly born baby boy, a boy that they both knew was special and beautiful. The mother's love really is like God's love. Can you see that? He loves us not because we're lovable, but because it's his nature to love and because we are his children. Mothers love because he gives his nature to them to love. God's nature. Beautiful. This newborn baby is described as beautiful. Doesn't every mother think that her newborn baby is the most beautiful baby ever? I think grandmothers think the same thing. I know that when my son was born, I could not imagine that there was, and this is true, this is like so true, that I could not imagine that there was a more beautiful child, despite his little cone head and full of an abundance of black hair. My desire was immediately to protect and nurture and keep safe my baby boy no matter what. Now, Yoshi, her love outweighed any fear that could have creeped in from the king's order. She and Amram knew their child was special. This baby was truly beautiful, maybe a little different than my son, but this baby was truly beautiful because the glory of God, Shekinah glory, could already be seen on him. His little face shone bright right from the very beginning. Mothers particularly carrying an unwavering faith in their children. Love believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. We should also not downplay for a moment the faith that both of these parents had that the Lord would protect their child. God protects his children like babies. On her sides you shall be carried and be dangled on her knees. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you, says the Lord. That's Isaiah 66. God will also comfort, nurture, protect, and provide security for each one of us. God's ability to provide each of us with the kind of mother's love that comes from his very nature of love and his faith in us. After all, he is our creator, just like he was the creator of this baby who will come to be known as Moses. Whether your mom was good at providing you with this type of love and security or not, you can rest assured that God does and will forever. On this Mother's Day, lean into him, experience his presence and his love, no matter what your age. But when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him and daubed it with asphalt and pitch, put the child in it and laid it in the reeds by the river's bank. And his sister stood afar off to know what would be done to him. Yoshi created a mini ark for her baby, an ark not unlike the one that Noah created for his family, one that would give her baby boy a chance. Her faith was placed in God to protect her child when she could not. The Nile was not a safe place with snakes and crocodiles, in addition to the risk of the ark not holding and the baby drowning. Did Yoshi have any idea what was about to happen? No, she trusted in the Lord and then placed her baby in the Nile the safest way that she knew how. Yoshi closed her baby boy inside of an ark for God's protection, just like God closed Noah and his family in the ark for protection against the flood. What irony. Pharaoh wanted the babies thrown into the river to die. The baby was carefully placed in the river so that God could give him life. And so Yoshi placed her baby into the river in the most protective and nurturing environment that she could. This was not just any old basket, like we often call it, or the pictures that we see. His sister Miriam also was very concerned. She was a young girl and was very concerned about the safety and well-being of her little brother. She stood afar watching to see what would become of him. And then the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, and her maidens walked along the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the reeds, she sent her maid to get it. And when she opened it, she saw the child. And behold, the baby wept. So she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." So here we're introduced to Pharaoh's daughter. She too, whether she knew it or not, was created in the image of God, endowed with the very nature and characteristic of a mother's love. So she had compassion on him as he cried out. What happens next can only be God going before his daughters in his creative and miraculous fashion. Then his sister Miriam said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call a nurse?" Yeah, any old nurse. "For you from the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." Can you imagine what Miriam must have been feeling and thinking? She was about to go and get her mother to take care of her brother. The Lord was working a miracle in front of her, and she was following his guidance. Miriam, like her mother, had faith and was courageous. Her heart was in the right place with the desire for her brother to live and be nurtured in the safe arms of his and her mother. Miriam was destined to become a prophetess. We know that about her. Her name means bitterness, and she's watching over the baby who was expected to experience a great wrong that would cause great bitterness. She was a visionary in this moment, and we know she is prophetic in her later years. So how much did she see from afar? She intervened so that he could be delivered back to his mother. It's such a beautiful story. So the maiden Miriam went and called the child's mother. And then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages." And so Yoshi had her baby boy back at least for a while. In those days, mothers nursed their babies until they were about 3 or 4 years old. This is important. This is no small blessing. This baby was back with mom and dad for the very early years of teaching. Not only that, the princess paid them to care for their baby. Think on that for a moment. These parents were slaves, and slaves did not get paid. Amram and Yoshi were paid to train their child in the ways of the one true God. How beautiful is that? Train up your child. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Yoshi and Amram were given time to nurture and bury the commands of the Lord deep into the heart of their little boy. We may think that those early years don't mean much. Little children are like sponges. And some even trace their coming to faith back to early childhood. We have lots of those little ones who will be running around here this summer. The Lord is calling us to teach them diligently. The biggest grouping is in that 3 to 5 year old range. Moses was destined for great things, and his parents already knew that they had a very special child. This period of time was not just a blessing for these parents, it was part of God's broader plan. Can you see it? To prepare Moses for the day would come when he would be called upon. Yes, there was to be a time to come of great sacrifice when Yoshi would need to give him up. I can't even imagine. But the alternative was certainly better than what would have happened to him otherwise. God had saved her son. Yoshi had thought that she had lost her baby boy forever. God opened the pathway to bring him home to her for those critical and formative years. And then, as she had promised, she needed to hand him back to the Lord. You see it that way? And the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. So she called his name Moses, because I drew him out of the water. Yoshi had to let go of her son and sacrifice him into the arms of another woman. What is a woman willing to do in order to secure the safety of her child's future? In this case, she was to let him go. Yet he went to live in a palace, a place where he would be taught by another woman who was to be his second mother. He was loved by her too, for she had compassion on this baby boy that her father would otherwise have murdered. Delivered and now brought to the palace to grow and be trained in all the ways and knowledge of Egypt. Egypt had great knowledge, which was especially important for a boy being raised as a prince. Let us understand that this daughter of Pharaoh, a princess, believed in the Nile god. And the Nile god was the god of fertility. The princess may very well have thought that the god of the Nile was answering her prayer for a divine child. Yet we know that answered prayer came from the one true God. An Egyptian princess was to be utilized by God to play a part in the deliverance of the children of Israel. Her great love for righteousness was played out in her compassionate, nurturing, and loving response to this little baby in the river. She was called upon by the Lord to be a part of this child's life. For you see, Bithia, if I'm saying her name correctly, that was her name, means daughter of Jehovah. Her name means daughter of God. Her name describes her true calling. She was to be an integral part of the story that demonstrated her female faith, desire to love, nurture, protect, keep, and yes, even sacrifice for this young boy so that he could be loved and trained and live. God's love is so great that his plans will not be thwarted by human intervention. His nature is love, and because we are his children, Jesus says, and I did have a great picture of this scripture I'm about to read, but I didn't have time to get it in here. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill prophets and stones, those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. It's like this big, huge thing, right? Moses was gathered and protected in the most unusual way. So as we conclude this chapter of Moses' life, we see the Lord utilized women in a mighty way, midwives who had courage to stand up for life, a mother who also did not fear the king's order, keeping her child hidden, a sister who stood by and watched and was in the right place at the right time, a princess who had compassion and love to raise a son, one not her own. Compassion that included ensuring the right type of nurturing in his growing years. Women with a mission to deliver a baby from death to life so that God could use him for the purpose in which he was born into this world. Women that displayed great faith, women that nurtured, protected, and provided security for a newborn child. A woman that sacrificed the raising of her child to another woman who took on the much-needed role to train up the child and ensure that he received the needed education. God's daughters, quiet, yet powerfully strong, compassionate, resilient, and motherly. All of these things wrapped together to show us a glimpse of who God is and how God loves us like a mother too. It also shows how God shows up from within us during times of adversity. This is not to say that fathers are not needed. It's also not to say that Amram was not important in the early life of Moses. We will hear more about how a father's love comes together with a mother's love to give us the full image of God that family life was originally designed to be. Pastor Scott will pick up that side of the story on Father's Day. But for today, let us consider the women that we know. Can we see these attributes of God in these daughters of the king? Maybe some more than others. Hearts that are as beautiful as this springtime flower. Women of faith. Women that desire to nurture the little ones in our midst, providing protection and security. Women that are willing to sacrifice in whatever way necessary for their children. Agape love, that perfect and unconditional love that comes from the heart of God through women in such a special way. Women that sit here with us today. In honest reflection, I found preparing to preach this passage difficult. Why? Because we live in a world where ungodliness is everywhere, and I can see the elements of the evil described in this passage played out in our times. Yesterday, the Lord got a hold of me saying, Lori, you are being asked to preach this message as a message of encouragement, a message of great hope, not despair. Yahweh used many women in this story. Yahweh made a way when the way seemed impossible. Be encouraged. Just stop for a moment and take a look at the beauty God designed into this heart-shaped flower. It is a picture of life, a picture of Christ, and a picture of God's perfect love. If the Lord was so careful in his design for this flower, how careful do you think he was when he designed the first woman? How careful when he designed you? Do you think that if our Lord allows us into a difficult scenario like he allowed these women so long ago, that for you too, he will not have a clear and holy path for you to follow? a much greater purpose than you can even begin to imagine. Community, connected to one another, bringing out the plan of God. So be encouraged. God's power and wisdom and strength to do all things is within us. We simply need to be like those women were and do what he tells us to do. We all have a part to play in the grand plan of the Lord's design. Remember that you and you and you and you are the daughters of the Most High God. Do you know that? Do you feel that? Do you sense that? Daughters of the King. Be who God designed you to be. Allow the Spirit within to work and transform you into who God designed you to be, so that he can fulfill his purpose for you and for this world. Let's now stand. In particular today, Mother's Day. Men, young men, pray for the women that are in our midst. Pray for the mothers. As we go forward and we say, Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you that today on this day, we can celebrate the beauty that stands here, the beauty of your creative spirit, the beauty of your strength, the beauty of your wisdom, the beauty of your compassion, the beauty of a mother's nurturing and caring love. We thank you, Lord God, for each and every one that's standing here today, whether they're mother or not, whether they're older or younger, whether they're grandmother or not. We lift them up to you, Lord, and say, empower them, Holy Spirit, to be who you designed them to be in this world that needs you so much. For yes, Lord, we all do need mothering now and again. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being in our midst today. It's in your holy and precious name, Lord Jesus, that we believe and we pray. Amen.
Scott, can you mute this while I plug it in?
The wind is blowing down the quiet river, a shining road that carries you alone. Baby boy, my love will last forever if you're too late. I must give you up to God. I know our God will guide, protect, and keep you. Teach you faith and hold you by the heart. Though your mother's heart is broken by your leaving, her father knows just who he is and who you are. I wish that life wasn't always ending up this way, with heaven's love at stake and hell to pay. But you and God's loving plan might be the missing part. You must live so I give you to his heart. The wind, it blows you down the silent river. leaves me all alone. A life for you is worth losing you forever. Someday we'll stand in God's fair land forever home. I wish that life wasn't always ending up this way, with heaven's love at stake and hell to pay. But you in God's loving plan might be the missing part. You must live so I give you to his heart. I wish that life wasn't always ending up this way, with heaven's love at stake and hell to pay. But you in God's loving plan might be the missing part. You must live so
Natalie, for that beautiful, beautiful rendition of that song. Ladies, I'd like you to stay put for a couple seconds when I finish so we can get to the back to get the flowers and your gifts all ready. In the back, you will meet myself, Frank, Jim Rubish, and Tom Smith. We will be handing things out to you as you leave this afternoon. But I'd like you now, ladies, to bow your heads. And men, I would like you to gather around these women. Place your hands on them. Put your hands in the air. Invoke God's blessing, as I do for them. To all the women of this earth, I pray that you will know your Heavenly Father as a beautiful and loving daughter. I pray that you will grow in his ways, knowing him, loving him, and obeying him always, and that his perfect love may descend upon you so that you may continue to love us and care for us the way that you do, that makes our lives as men much, much more rich to know you, Father, in that perfect love. And now may the love of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever, come and descend upon you and remain with you always. And all of God's ladies said, amen. Amen. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.
Let us sing power and majesty, praise to the King.